classrooms, we're working the problems out. If you're not bringing your materials to the classroom and working with us, until Hunter I sees you, we're going to ask you to leave. If you're not coming to class to, you know, to work the problems, then you shouldn't be here. We shouldn't be wasting our time. We have another 4 class periods before the exam. We're going to cover homework 4 and then homework 5. I expect you to be young professionals and to follow along with what we're doing. I have no objection to meeting with you personally or whatever you want to call it. I don't think Bill Ami does either. But we cannot take you as you, you know, just show up. And so we've set up the recitations, and I think you're not going to do recitations next week when you're going to have office hours, right? Oh, okay, sorry, my mistake. Did you also want to do the other thing? Did you want to have a happy hour on Sunday afternoon? 2 to 5, you said? 2 to 5, your office. 2 to 5, Dylan will be in his office. I'll be around. We will be writing the exam. We sort of already have. Don't be looking around or trying to, because the exam can look just like the homework. That'll be harder. There are 6 problems now. Yeah. And Mr. Caraway, where are you? Yeah. We're going to add a problem because you annoyed me. So, what should we do with number 7? How about that really crappy looking one? That CO2, or no, it's nitrogen injection. How do y'all feel about that? That's the problem just because of Mr. Caraway? I'm a devout socialist. If I give it to one of you, I have to give it all of you. And how many of you believe America is not a socialist country? We're working on it. Yeah, that's a good point. Bill, we're going to go through our little inventory from hell. We're going to find another problem for that punishment. All right, today we're going to cover fractured wells. So I need your absolute undivided attention, because what's going to happen is we're going to look at the fractured well case first. Without wellbore storage, that's not going to work, because we know the wellbore storage is going to affect this. And then we're going to look at the fractured well for infinite conductivity and then for finite conductivity. Before we do that, let's start. Diagnostically, what do we need to do to this case? The first thing I want to do is I want to pick up both of these. And I'm going to project them. So should we perform the analysis on the effective time, or should we perform the analysis on the non-effective time? Are they the same? Where's the difference? Only the very end. Now, because there's been a run on the vellum paper and we have a limited supply, if you get an exam problem that is only effective time, then that's all you're going to be expected to work. There will be a couple of problems that probably will have 2 plots, this, you know, these 2 plots. But on another case or 2, we simply don't have enough paper to do that. So those of you who have been buying up my stash, now you know the penalty is that, plots, although that automated happen. It's kind of a weird sort of twist. Sorry?
Are you buying
double
table?
Please wait until Wednesday to do that, because we're supposed to get a supply, you know. And for some reason, the student worker who has ordered this doesn't understand that they can, no, but she doesn't understand that she can actually go over there and get it, you know, that sort of thing. Yeah. Or maybe you could go over there and get it. Oh no, then you take it.
Yeah.
Forget you. Okay. So do we want to work both of these plots? What do you think? It's a waste of time. Is that what you said? Why don't you stand up and show everybody your straight pride t-shirt? Is this George Strait? Fortunately for the tenure, I probably won't be fired, but it's okay. You want to wear both of these? All right, that's fine. Diamonds are made under pressure. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to look at the non-storage case. I'm just sort of throwing things out here, trying to figure out what this might be. Can't turn it sideways, Tom. Sorry about that, class. Does anybody see anything that remotely looks interesting?
No.
How about that? Okay, but this is the worst well test of the whole course. All right? And you can blame Dr. Lee for this because he put in his paper, and I found, you know, back when people actually put data in their paper, I found these three cases and I give you homeworks on them and that sort of thing. But this is the most difficult to diagnose case that you're ever going to see. Why? Because it looks simple, but it's not. You're going to have to make a judgment. What you want to do is you want to come over here, right? That's what everybody wants to do. And clearly, that ain't a match. Okay, so the next question is it high conductivity or is it low conductivity? Because this is a quasi-democracy, as evidenced by Mr. Stone's First Amendment right to wear his stupid t-shirt, and me to express my, you know, feelings about that. I don't know really what else to say. I'll leave it at that. Okay, this is a low conductivity case. This is an FCD or a CFD of 1. That means that the fracture conductivity, CFD is defined as what? It's the width of the fracture multiplied by the permeability in the fracture, or the permeability of the fracture, divided by the permeability of the formation and the length of the fracture. Okay. So the lower the conductivity of the fracture, WKM, that's what we're going to see here. So this is absolutely low. This is a 1-to-1 ratio of permeability multiplied by width in the fracture and permeability of formation and the fracture happening. So this is pretty low. I mean, there might be lower cases than this in your experience, but this is getting low. This is a bad fracture. It's a low conductivity fracture. When you guys, I guess you already had Dr. Valco, right? But Dr. Valco used to teach the production class, and he would spend an inordinate amount of time explaining that you design for a dimensionless conductivity of 10. That's what the service company wants you to do. And then you probably deliver a dimensionless conductivity of 1, although they don't want to know that. So, you know, there's roughly this factor. And it turns out that he also looked at a correlation, and from a sort of a physics standpoint, a fracture conductivity of 1 has some merit, that you're not putting too much permeability or too much effort into creating a permeable fracture for what you're going to get out of it. But a fracture conductivity of 1 is low. That is not what you're going to expect, and that's not what the company's going to design. Okay, so did anyone see a match with this? Oops, we're going to be up a creek here, class. Bill Hunt, why are we going to be up a creek? Have any of you done this case yet? What? Oh, they are. How did that happen? Did you load these in? Did you load these in? You loaded these. Did you check the size?
Yes, I did.
Which ones are? Scales?
How do you adjust the scales?
You can't.
How do you know it's the right scale?
Because they have to be exactly the same.
Is it square?
Size of yourself here, but then the layout's not going to be right. We need to do this ourselves and make sure that we can get this to fit right. Okay. We'll make it fly. It's going to take a little while. We'll fix it. Okay. Well, in that absence. Let's be cool, Javi, and let's go over what is not scale dependent. So in other words, the problem right now is the type curves are scaled correctly, that's okay, but these graphics are scaled at 84%, and we'll have to fix that. So we'll remount immediately. If you want to go ahead and go work on that now. And you may, Bill, you may have to trim the edges of the JPEG in Picture Editor, not in Microsoft Word, to get it to fit at 100%. If you have to change the dynamic on the page width, watch what happens to the page number and that header. I have to do that on page 3. Okay, so let's do this another way. We're all here. Let's have some fun. I love it when a plan comes together. All right, what was your question again, Mr. Stone? What more storage? brought my good glasses today. Yeah, there's a unit slow plan for World War storage. So, Ms. Bagnell, you're telling us that you are also the recipient of a Louisiana public school education? Right. Okay, so why am I drawing all these lines, class? There is no third slope, but there may be a fourth. Okay, I'm going to scoot the quarter slope up here. Here's the quarter slope. And I'm going to scoot the half slope up here. Is this half slope class? Somebody said maybe. What does maybe mean? What's the other side of maybe? Maybe not. Okay, so this is the quarter. I didn't bother to draw in a half, but I will. See, some of you actually are paying attention. So how come Dr. Schechter's class was so raucous earlier? I'm sorry, stress
relief? Yeah, you made one. Talking about bubbles.
Bubbles? I don't know what you guys are saying. Okay, what does the half slope mean? High, CFB. And a quarter slope is low, CFB, right? Now these are the wrong scales, so just take notes on it. We'll fix it later. What else are we missing? Come on, guys, cut the chatter. Let's talk. Okay. Somebody decided they didn't want to be here. Oh, well, there's always next year. All right. So this is, this is 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, and this is 0.5. Okay, so 0.5, drawing through the beta derivative, it's close, it's not perfect. So this is delta t beta approximately equal to 0.5, and that would confirm the half slope. So it's not perfect. Neither is the data.
So if it was quarter slope,
it would validate that particular regime would be a horizontal line at one quarter. Okay, but right now it's a horizontal line at one half. So it's a diagnostic. It's a mechanism for us to assess this. This is the worst case. I want to repeat that over and over again. So is it perfectly linear flow? No. Is it perfectly bilinear flow? No. So what do we have to do? Well, unfortunately, the type curve's the wrong scale, but we're gonna have to go to the type curve and hope for the best. What's the most important thing that you can say about this? Is this radial flow? There are three options. Yes, no, or maybe. How many of you say yes? How many of you say no? How many of you say maybe? That's one person was honest enough to say yes, but if you were in an exam scenario, you'd probably all think it was radial flow. It's not radial flow. Now, there's also a part of the derivative over here, which is kind of flat. It's not so evident on this case, but there are other cases when you start looking at the type curve where there's a flat regime. This is not radial flow. Okay.
So, like, are we looking, I guess, towards really the derivative or like the actual delta p in terms of that, or really focusing?
What's happening here is that this is a fractured well with wellbore storage with some flow regime. We think it's linear or somewhere near linear. We think it's going to be high conductivity. It may be, it may not be. This is the problem. We really can't tell what this is. And then at the end, we don't really have radial flow. So what does it mean when you don't have radial flow? One word. What's the word? Permeability. And if you don't have permeability, you cannot fix the vertical axis. So this analysis basically stops now. It will be indeterminate when we start trying to match it against the type curve. There will be a best fit. And that is the one we'll go with. When we get the plots properly sized, we'll do that on Monday quickly. But this one does not have radial flow. It does have some bilinear or linear flow, we're not sure which. It does have wellbore storage. I neglected to mention the wellbore storage is marked here. I guess I should do that for completeness. But here's the wellbore storage line. Delta P beta is equal to 1, that's wellbore storage. And this is high conductivity. But I want to warn you, this is a strange dub. It's not going to work out the way you think. Now, on the exam, we're not going to give you something this complicated. We're going to give you something that has enough information to tie you to something. Yes?
Do you have enough data to analyze this perfectly, or is this just a case where the...
This is a case, it's a great question, because this is a case where somebody came along and did not run their test long enough, and that's all we're seeing. So I could do the same thing like this. Now, unfortunately, the plot is not scaled correctly, but you can imagine, well, let's look at another case. This is a conductivity of 10. Let's say in your imagination that we were able to approximately fit it somewhere on this grid, okay? Now, let's say that we did that. You can see we're a mile away from radial flow. We're three log cycles away from radial flow. So suggesting to yourself that you're anywhere close to radial flow, this. And the reason that this class is not a bust today, even though the graph isn't scaled correctly, is because this happens a lot, and it's going to get worse, because what's going to control your ability to get to radial flow is permeability. So if this is a very low permeability system, it will build up for a very long time before it gets to radial flow. So how do you trick the reservoir into telling you what the permeability is? This is a trick question. How do you trick the reservoir into telling you what the permeability is? If conventional pressure transient test analysis tells you that you cannot estimate permeability, you're at something like, what, 60 hours there, 50 hours, and it's going to be another, you know, 10,000 hours, and that could actually happen in the field. You know, how do you trick it?
You do something with changing the rate or changing the time that you use.
Okay, but the propagation, the equation that you use, still assumes a certain characteristic behavior that isn't being met, that permeability doesn't control that equation. So changing the rate isn't going to help. But you're on the right track. What could we do instead?
Use some other quantity in the zone?
No. Stop thinking about well test analysis. How can you trick this thing into giving you an estimate of permeability?
Is it a procedural thing or is it an analysis thing?
Well, if we had production data, we could try to do that. But unfortunately, early production data is often masked by all sorts of cleanup effects when you have water coming back from the stimulation treatment, etc. And this is seriously aggravated for shale gas wells, tight gas wells, and so on. I think we can get around it. But having been to two meetings this week where I begged people to take bottom hole pressures because the surface pressures are corrupted by the whatever's going on in the wellbore, you know, they laughed you out of the room. But if you had that data, I think you could do something with it. But production data is not going to save you. What's going to save you is either running an MDT device, which is a wireline conveyed device, which you can put a pad against the formation and pump out of the formation or pump into the formation, and you can do a localized test. And there are equations for hemispherical flow that you can match on, just like you do in other kinds of well testing. Every service vendor has that technique. Now, but we want something bigger than this. We want an actual test of the reservoir. Whoever's popping their gum, swallow it. And if they don't, the person next to it squeeze their throat until it pops out of their mouth and their nose or something else. Okay? So, how can we do it another way? Okay, a pulse test is what's going to happen between two positions. If I want to think about it this way, and I put a rope between you and me, and I yank the rope one way or yank the rope the other, the physics are still the same. It's going to take time for that propagation to, but you're on the right track. Can we pulse the well alone? Yes. And the way we would do that is have a very rapid injection, nitrogen, CO2, could be water, into the formation, and then let it fall off. So you're conducting a very localized test. But those things usually turn out to be crap. Why? It's not storage because you got a package, but you're on the right track. The package leaks, things don't make sense. Also, these are called mini frac tests. They're designed to be, you're going to break down the formation. What the frac company wants is they want an estimate of what pressure it's going to take to break down the formation so they can design the frac job around it. If you're going to do two things at once, if you're going to inject into the formation to break the formation down to estimate the fracture pressure, and you're going to flow back, then there's a possibility you could infer permeability. I want to warn you, this is very gray area stuff. It requires expert level, you know, data, equipment, interpretation, and so forth. And I went through this yesterday with some guys up in California. You know, you have to, you know, for a field in Canada, you really have to have a lot of control. And if you tell me that Joe Smith, you know, ran the fracture or the mini frac test, I'm probably not going to believe the results. No offense, Mr. Smith. But if you tell me that, well, in this case, what? I wasn't thinking of you. Although, you know, I guess I could. If you told me that the guy who's recognizing this did it, then I'd have a lot more faith in it. But you have to, I mean, if you don't remember anything else from today's lecture, you have to have an estimate of permeability, either to perform a well test on a fractured well, or to calibrate, however you want to say it. But if you don't have an estimate of permeability, and you end up with flow regimes like this, you're going to be out of luck. It's going to be very difficult to interpret the test. Yes?
Are you talking about fracture permeability?
No. I'm talking about formation. When I say permeability, I always mean formation permeability. Sorry. When I say fracture conductivity, I'm talking about what the fracture's packed in. So there's your nomenclature for the day. But you know, I took this class 25 years ago, and somebody told me that you had to have an estimate of formation permeability. And the guy that told me was the guy who stole this well test, and we put him up here on the wrong scale. That's okay. Actually, they're on the right scale. And the question really is, why is that still true today? Because it's physics are identical. We cannot analyze flow regimes. Well, let's think about it another way. What do we get out of well bore storage? Just a great exam question. What do we get from this blue lab? What does the analysis of this blue line give us? Well, it gives us M well bore storage. And what does M well bore storage give us? It gives us CS. And what does CS give us? It gives you the volume of the well bore. What the hell gives that? Okay. And then we come over here and we have a high FCD. So what estimate do we get? That means that fracture conductivity, CFD, is approximately equal to infinity. So the result parameter that we're going to get is we're going to get a lump value that has what? It's going to be K, formation permeability, and XF squared. And then for the low FCD case, we're going to get a lump parameter that's what? Anybody? Still going to be K, XF squared, but now it's also going to include CFD. And I'm not talking about, I need to put commas in between here, because it'll be a lump parameter that includes all these. Okay? So that means that you have a single value, a number, alpha equals something. And that something has permeability and XF in it. How do you get it out? You either got to know permeability or you got to know fracture happening. The whole reason we're doing this is to estimate fracture happening. So you got to know permeability. The next one is on the low FCD because CFD case, you've now got permeability, fracture happening, and fracture conductivity. So this looks pretty much indeterminate. And it is, unless you can get an estimate of permeability. Now this is why we do things by hand. Because when you go to the vendors, what are they going to tell you to do? Mr. Cobb? Sorry? Click on which button? Well, in French, that software is called Improve. In the Canadian version of software, I think it's Synthetic Match or something like that. But all it is an algorithm like Solver. And it's going to go find a match. And how good are the numbers going to be? It depends. I mean, if the permeability is not that big an issue for that particular case, maybe it'll find a reasonable estimate. Possibility is it'll be off by 1,000. Now, this is why people present you with data sets and they say, I calculated permeability to be 0.1 millidarcies, when you know the permeability is 0.0001 millidarcies. That happens all the time. And it's because people are regressing on it, or they're matched it incorrectly, or that sort of thing. This happens all the time. So that error propagates. So this is kind of like, you know, Dr. House, where they misinterpret whether the guy's got a brain tumor or an infection or a bullet lodged in his head. I mean, this is the first of those kinds of cases where it's really difficult to distinguish. So let's move away from well number 5. We'll come back and talk about him or her later on.
Tom, did you have a case
where
he played exactly
on the type of the Absolutely. Case? And the next two will.
Okay.
The next two will. Okay? This is well number 10. Both blocks. Does anybody see any difference except when I move them? Are they essentially identical? Yeah. So we can analyze either one. I'll set this one aside for a moment. This is well number 12. Both plots. Is there any difference whatsoever? No, because the time of shut-in is something like 25 hours, and the time of drawdown is 700 hours. So that one, you can forget about that one too. All right, let's come back to this one. This is well number 5. It's also misscaled. Sorry, thank you. Yeah, English never was my strong suit. Being a Louisiana public school graduate. All right, Ms. Bagno, you ready? All right, so we've got a unit slope line. We're going to match wellbore storage. What's going to be the problem with this case?
What else could it be?
It could be that there's a water leg coming up and it hits the tubing from below, and that would change the storage coefficient. Okay. What else could it be? Okay, so you're already thinking the casing's not enough. You're going to have another string of tubing.
Well, I could have another casing for a while.
That's what I just said. Maybe I should have drawn a picture. In that case, one of them is called the casing, the other one's called the tubing. I'd recommend that you put, you know, 2 7/8 and then switch down to 2 3/8. I probably wouldn't do that, but you could. You know, that's the kind of thing that people like Mr. Harlan, when they're out on their own, you know, they only have so much 2 3/8 and so much 2 7/8. Is that right, Mr. Harlan?
Yeah, I'm going to send you the data.
Yeah, I figured you would. Anybody else got any ideas? I told you once, and I'll tell you again, there are things that happen in the wellbore that look like reservoir effects. Now I'm going to turn it around. There are things that happen in the reservoir that look like wellbore effects. So you've already all explained within some degree of reason that I'm willing to accept, except for the I don't know crew and the tell me later crew. You know, that somehow the storage coefficient changed. I buy that. I believe that's probably most likely. Delhan, what else can we match this with? What else can we match changing wellbore storage with? Good guess. Good guess. It could be a dual permeability case. Very good. Could be dual porosity. The two-layer model has a nasty habit of doing this too. And so you start looking at this, and you'll start to see a lot of well tests that have this dual slope thing. And you'll come to the conclusion that it's a multi-layer effect. Don't come to that conclusion. Go do what, Mr. Powell? Go look at the wellbore diagram. Draw a picture of it and ask yourself what's going on. This could also be a leak. Nobody said that. Ooh, kind of sneaky, huh? Yes. And of course, since it's in the wellbore storage domain, do we care? Absolutely not. Why, Christine? Because it does not affect our interpretation of the reservoir signal, which is way out on the other, on the right side, correct? But knowing something about what happened in the wellbore, you can go back to someone and tell them, hey, I think we got a problem. We have a pressure buildup test that we really should give, but it's unfortunately on the previous exam, where you can see the packer slip, Kelsey. You can actually see it.
What do you later on, you can't match wellbore storage at UTR?
Are you worried about how you would match this on a type curve? In this case, use the second one.
Okay.
Yes. And we can validate that what I'm saying is true because we have not only the unit slope line, but we also have the beta derivative. Sorry? I can't hear you.
Is that the solid line, is the correct one?
Yes, the solid line would be the one I would use for analysis.
Is that because they were able to continue?
No, it's because that's the second one. I don't think I meant it to be funny, sorry. It's kind of like a laugh track. If I went off there, this is one, and it is what was good. And it sort of reverses and does it again, as you can see. There's a little portion of it there. So, it's like a sequel. This is number one, this is number two.
But how does that validate the number two, correct?
Sorry?
How does that validate the number two?
How does it validate what?
The solid line.
No, we see. We're not validating anything. What we're going to do when we perform the model that we assume for the wellbore storage type curve is a constant storage model. If we use the first one and it changes, then that model's not right. So let's just use the second. It's an imperfect fix, but there's nothing else we can do. Now the software, both the Canadian and the French versions, am I correct, Bill, how they both have a changed wellbore storage option. But do not go wild with this change in wellbore storage, because you can match anything with it. You can match the color of my hair, you can match my coveralls, whatever you want. Be very careful with that changing wellbore storage option. Does anyone see a fractured well in this particular data set? What do you see, class? Do you see a horizontal derivative here? And this is approximately 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700. So this would be delta P prime RF. It's approximately 700 psi. What's the remainder of this? Is this a boundary effect? Which is it? We don't know. Can we match it with the boundary effect, Johan? All day long, right? Somebody tell me where you see fractured well behavior in this data set. Okay, so we're going to mark this is wellbore storage domination. Wellbore storage.
How big of a reach do you want to ask?
Sorry, louder?
How big of a reach do you want to ask the next one if you're asking about fractured wells? Like a fracture? I mean, I can see one that kind of matches the quarter set. Probably cut like a couple of points.
Mr. Harlan, come in, Kevin. Okay, we're looking at the derivative, or at what?
No, you're talking about the...
You're talking about the green, blue, or red?
The red.
The red. You see a quarter slope?
Okay. I mean, like I said, it's kind of a reach to...
Well, reaching seems to be what we do best. Let's see, class, am I pretty funny?
Yeah. You control their grade, they're going to say it anyway.
I see. May I? Or would you like to?
No,
you do. I'm good. It's nice to hear your hat. No, I meant just help yourself. Right there. All right, I'm going to go. Let me write it down.
See, you told you were going to
write it. Did you spit on this?
It's a duplication. You know about that.
Thank you, little Shepherd. Quarter slope by my new BFF here. Let's try the half. Clayton, did you ever go to Faith Healer?
I'm trying to figure out where this is going.
You ever go to a medicine man?
Yeah.
Class, how many of you agree with Mr. Harlan's interpretation? If he were right, what would have to happen? That'd be him, sorry. Well, yes, that's true. But more importantly, if this were the case, it would have to be reflected in the derivative and the beta derivative, right? So here's the derivative at a quarter. And here's this. Clayton, you want to rethink your lines here?
Can you not do the analysis lower for distortion?
Sorry, louder?
Are you not doing analysis lower for distortion, right?
I'm doing what Mr. Harlan said.
It's just a linear function?
Well, my whole point is,
I mean, yeah, some of that quarter slope does go a little bit forward, but I think some of it feeds and radial. That's why I was asking, is how much do you really want us to...
All right, let's slow down. I know class time's over, but I want you to think about this real quick. How many of you believe that those lines are real, that they represent fractured well regimes? Let's take a very serious vote, and I want you to listen to my voice. How many of you believe yes? And how many of you believe no? How many of you believe yes? How many of you believe no?
No!
Yes. That is correct. So what happened to this well? If you read the paper, the well was fracture stimulated. Now, Ms. Sleeve, may I? No, let's torture your table mates here. Gentlemen, if you can put your heads together. I'm going there in the office. Okay. Sorry. Oh, well, it'll be beyond layoffs then. If I fracture stimulate a well, and it does not look like it's been fracture stimulated, what's your conclusion? It's these two. Silence. I'm going to make you hold hands. Come on. You said you're just going to touch. Okay. Now, if I fracture stimulate the well, and it does not look like it's been fracture stimulated from this plot, what's your conclusion? There are two distinct possibilities. You paid for a fracture treatment job that was not performed. That'd be a little bit difficult to prove, you know, or to believe. The trucks pull up, they have people, you know, running around and things like that. But did you pay for a fracture treatment that didn't work? What's the possibility that the fracture treatment didn't work? What was the thing I told you to remember today? That if you don't have an estimate of permeability or you don't have radial flow, you can't analyze a fractured well test. What I'm going to tell you, number two thing to remember today is what? Whenever someone comes to you and they say, I've done 1,000 frac jobs, you have nothing to worry about. I know what I'm doing. You don't have to check my design. You don't have to do this. You don't have to do that. Stop. Recheck the design. Recheck how it's going to be executed. I've seen an academic, at least half a dozen cases where where somebody said, I'm going to do a small company, said I'm going to use company X, and we're going to fracture stimulate the reservoir, and you know, this is our first time, and they swear nothing will go wrong. And what goes wrong?
Everything.
What's the one thing that can go wrong in a treatment that you cannot do anything about? Jailbreaker. Once you place it in the formation, it's sand inside of jello. You design the thing to where it breaks, correct? The gel dissolves and you produce the water back. What happens if the gel doesn't dissolve? You just created a cement plug, you created a fracture, and then you cement plugged it up with jello. How are you going to get it out? Sorry? Re-stimulate. That's times two now to achieve the same thing. Do you think you're going to re-stimulate and fix everything that you caused a problem? No. Be very careful. This is number two thing I want you to remember today. Number three thing I want you to remember today is always check your scales on the grass.